As all of you are aware, Hillsborough Road, for, or Fifth Avenue, as we like to call it, for many years has had problems with chronic and recurrent flooding. Some of the properties on Fifth Avenue lie within the flood fridge overlay, and it's certainly created a challenge after the May of 2010 flood as far as what some of these businesses and landowners could do with their property. It's been a concern for the Board of Mayor and Aldermen, and of course we've discussed this and had multiple meetings, and one of the approaches to trying to evaluate this problem was to apply for a grant with the American Planning Association. And that's what we're here tonight, is to listen to a report from the CPAT team from the American Planning Association. I would like to point out that everyone that's here is a volunteer. They've come to Franklin with their own personal time. We have paid for their expenses, but I think that if we calibrated how much pay they got, it would probably be close to an elected official as far as time put in. So, I mean, we're glad that you're getting this experience. Secondly, I'd like to thank our staff that worked very, very hard to get the grant from the American Planning Association, and in particular would single out Kelly Dannenfelser, who not only did a great job in preparing the application for the grant, but also has been a true warrior this week as far as spending time with our team that's been here, and we're certainly indebted to that, and I know that she's extended a lot of Southern hospitality to them. I would like to create a few ground rules for the meeting tonight, if I could. They've requested that they be able to give their presentation in the entirety and not be have questions or interruptions during the presentation, but there will be a time after their presentation where they will be able to accept questions. Tonight is not their final report. This is an initial report that they worked very, very hard to create, and we'll have a final document at a later time. So, Kelly, have I covered everything so far? So the next thing will be that I'd like to ask Rich Roth, who's the team leader, to come up. And if he would, we actually have a small token of thanks to each one of the team members, and as you introduce them, I'd love to be able to personally give that to them and reflect our appreciation for the time that you've given to our city and your knowledge and your experience. And in fact, I would ask for a rousing round of applause after they're introduced. So, all right,
okay,
Rich.
Thank you, Mayor. Okay, I'm going to reverse this slide for the purpose of getting through the team members.
Let me interrupt you just first.
Okay.
You're the first one I'm going to present the gift to, and so we certainly appreciate your leadership on this, and you've done a great job, and it's been a great experience to meet you, and thank you so much.
Okay, thank
and
you,
now
Mayor.
Now you can go ahead to the next one.
Okay. And as you note there, I'm from Chicago area. Next is Tom Bassett. Tom is a APA staff member that has helped me to coordinate this thing, and he's out of the Washington, D.C. APA office. The next one is Bill Harris. Bill is from Georgia. He's an academic down there. I guess I can still say that. We're still far enough north. And next is Gail Henriksen from New Smyrna Beach, isn't it? Florida. She's a Wisconsin fan.
This weekend.
Those that don't know, Tennessee and Florida play this week.
The next team member is Mark Eber from, I believe he said Hollywood, California. That's why he's got the tan. And finally, Kim Burton from Columbus, Ohio. Okay, what is a CPAT? Well, CPAT is the Community Planning Assistance Team from the American Planning Association. APA asks members from across the country to apply if they're interested in being involved in this program. And what this is planning professionals from around the country. We have various specialties. We have a historical preservation, economic development, design, transportation, mitigation specialists, and myself, I'm a disaster mitigation specialist. So we've taken all these specialties, although we're all generalist planners too, and put them together to come to Franklin and work on this report. And we would like also to thank Kelly. She's been a gracious host and guide. She's run us all over town. We haven't just seen the study area. And actually, the entire planning department, they've just been great, provided us with a lot of information. And before we came, we really had a good understanding of the community because of the reams of documents that we received prior to coming here. Now, here are the study details on the Historic Franklin Flood Constraints Study. The study area is north of downtown Franklin. There's about 96 acres. Now, I can see this real good, but it kind of blends in. This is the study area along the Harpeth, down the Sharps Branch, along Bridge Street. Now, we were asked to look at a number of challenges the city of Franklin faces. The frequent flooding of these sites. There have been 10 floods in this area since 1929, and probably some smaller ones also. We were asked to look at the non-conforming uses in the area. Those are uses that don't conform with Franklin's ordinances. And we were asked to look at the non-contributing structures. They're non-contributing to the downtown character of the area. The objectives of the study were to develop solutions compatible with the floodplains that affect this area, develop solutions to provide a transition area or a gateway as you come into downtown Franklin from the north, develop solutions in context with what's there, and develop solutions to complement the new streetscapes that are going to be going in along Fifth Avenue, and develop solutions to promote economic development in the community. Now, as you can see from this slide, this is the floodplain along with the study area. The darker area is the deeper, faster flowing area known as the floodway, and the lighter blue area is the floodplain. Both of those areas have to be regulated as Franklin participates in the National Flood Insurance Program. Some examples of the flooding, they probably all lived through it and don't really have to see these, but sometimes people need to be reminded. In the business I'm in, we talk about having flood amnesia a couple years after the flood, so this is what was there. Now, as the mayor said, we are continuing after we leave here to work on this. We're going to be working tomorrow morning before we head to Nashville to fly out of town. And over the next several weeks, we're going to continue to work on it. We've had a lot of work that we've done since Monday morning. We looked at existing reports, plans, and regulations. Most of those we looked at home. We've taken walking and driving tours, both through the city and the study area, and we've had work sessions and research that we've done. We've had 7 stakeholder meetings, met with elected officials, nonprofit organizations, neighborhood groups, city staff, and property owners from the study area. We've had 1 public workshop on Tuesday night in which we divided into the various specialties, floodplain, economic development, urban design, open space, and mobility, and asked the attendees of the meeting to come and talk to us about these different areas and give us their 2 cents. Now, we have also focused on various areas in the study area. Again, these are the same topics that we went through during the meeting on Tuesday night. And we've divided the total study area into 5 sub-areas for the purpose of our review and for the recommendations that we will be giving. There's the Hill property, which is up here, the Bicentennial Park area over here, the east side of Fifth Avenue here, west side of Fifth Avenue, which actually takes in Ninth Avenue, and then we are making some recommendations regarding things that happen outside the study area or will affect the entire community. Now, for the Hill property, we've noted that it's outside the floodplain, so there's no floodplain regulations on any development that should take place there. However, since the one access road is closed due to the wall that is being put up there as part of the Fifth Avenue work, the one access to the site would be closed during a 100-year flood event. So anything that goes up there during a 100-year flood, you're basically not going to get out until the flood goes down. We've looked at the integrity with the cemeteries to the west. We've considered low-scale development. We've talked about a community center. We've talked about an interpretive center there, or a gateway feature, as you come in from the north, and possibly passive open space area or parking for the cemeteries. The second sub-area is the Bicentennial Park area. We've looked at possibly putting pervious parking, that's parking where the base allows water to go through, and the possibility of on-site flood storage. In other words, taking dirt out, and when the flood comes up, that would cover those, or that would take down some of the flooding downstream. Looked at the possibility of purchasing remaining private structures. Looked at possibility of a nature center or redeveloping the French's site. Possibly a visitor center or welcome center for both Franklin and for the park. We looked at finishing the park plan. We looked at cemetery and park connectivity, since you have 2 historical parks there. We looked at the possibility of pedestrian and bike uses, trailheads, and river multi-use paths to complement the path that's already there. And finally, again, parking for both the park and the cemeteries. Next sub-area is the east side of Fifth Avenue between Margin and Bridge. We looked at floodplain conformance. Portion of that area is in the floodplain. We looked at the possibility of elevation of structures, embankments that would block the floodwaters, open space, and other mitigation actions. We looked at possibly increasing the density in the area and mixed in retail and residential uses. We looked at redevelopment of some of the buildings with elevated buildings, 0 lot lines, and the development being in context and scale with what's adjacent to the property now. That would include looking at the possible maximum heights for any structures. We looked at the possibility of open air structures and other low or no impact uses. We looked at pedestrian and bike friendly streets, traffic calming, particularly on Bridge Street, and overflow parking for the businesses and for the park. And also we looked at the possibility of remediation for the dump site, which currently would have to be cleaned up if any use were to go there. Now, these are the existing traffic patterns through the site. You've got Fifth Avenue here, you got Bridge here, you got third extension, which will eventually go on to Fifth Hillsborough. We looked at the possibility of extending some pedestrian paths that would tie in with the, it would be the tan lines, which are the existing bike path that's gone in. We've looked at the west side of Fifth Avenue. We've looked at floodplain conformance issues, because any development would have to comply. Possibility of elevation of structures, embankments, purchasing structures and turning it into open space, and other possible mitigation actions, including stream maintenance for Sharps Branch. We looked at possibility of affordable housing, of redeveloping the warehouse. We've looked at, again, redevelopment of elevated buildings, zero lot line, and again, the context and scale of any development. We looked at the possibility of a community center and a cultural venue for the hard bargain area. We've looked at pedestrian and bike friendly streets, possibly a multi-use path along Sharps Branch, and possibility of improving the Mount Hope streetscape, and finally the connectivity of hard bargain to this area. These are examples of elevated structures that could be built here. Don't look for these anywhere in town. They're not there. These pictures are from out of town, but some of them would fit in very definitely with the architecture that is in this area. These are examples about floodproofing. The house on the bottom has vents around it. It's elevated, and the vents allow water to enter and exit the structure after a flood. And the two top ones are actually examples of flood vents. The flood vents stay closed normally, keep the critters out. And the one on the top right is water going out of the structure after a flood. Now, as I mentioned, we took one other area, and that's areas outside of the study area and other possible recommendations. We looked at a stream study for Sharps Branch. We looked at the possibility of recommending that the community apply for the community rating system. We looked at the possibility of a Sharps Branch stream maintenance program, and the possibility of suggesting that the city complete small area mitigation plans. We looked at the Kroger site north of the development, and the possible relocation of Sonic out of the floodway and floodplain and closer to their number one customers, as I understand it, the students from the high school, and not next to the high school where they're all going to go out after class. We looked at pursuing dense, mixed-use, pedestrian-friendly, bike-friendly development opportunities. We looked at tax increment financing districts, other funding options, and public-private partnerships. We looked at the possibility of some signs, some wayfinding signs, signs used in the gateway, and other possible markers. We looked at building planned multi-use path connections. We looked at other recreational uses of the river, such as park and rides for downtown from the area, and downtown bike trailheads. We looked at, even though it was outside of the area, the completion of Mac Hatcher would which would reduce some of the traffic that goes through there. I know we came in down Hillsborough, and we had a good example of the traffic on the way here, and we looked at connecting some of the greenways that are already here. Now, these are preliminary recommendations. I want to reinforce that, preliminary. What you're hearing right now is a postage stamp of what's going to be in there. We are going to take the next, tomorrow and probably the next couple of weeks, to put the final report together. It will then go to APA's headquarters in Washington to be completed. Basically, as I always like to say, it's made to look pretty. And in approximately a month, the final recommendation will come to the Board of Mayor and Aldermen of the City of Franklin. For the Hill property, we are recommending low-scale, non-intrusive, community-oriented development, or the possibility of just keeping it open, possibly putting some parking there for the cemeteries. It wouldn't be blocked during a flood. Bicentennial Park area, the area north of Park Margin, complete the park plan. No private development north of Margin. And anything that is put there is complementary to the park uses, such as a visitor center and parking. East of Fifth Avenue, south of Margin, any buildings that are constructed be elevated above the flood fringe, the base flood elevation. City should consider a variety of uses that complement the historic districts that's there. And no development in the floodway. That could include buying out at least one structure that's in the floodway. West of Fifth Avenue and south of Mount Hope, we're recommending building elevated structures above the flood fringe, again above the base flood elevation. A variety of uses. Again, there has to be height and scale compatibility, and again, no development in the floodway. That again, that might mean buying out one or two structures that do go in the floodway. And by the way, in our report, we're going to be talking about possible financing options for these structures, both from FEMA and some other agencies at possible foundations. And finally, north of Mount Hope, no development in the floodplain along Fifth Avenue, which would mean, again, a couple structures would have to be bought out. What are the next steps after the report is, or after we leave here today? We're going to wrap up in Franklin. We've got work to do tomorrow before we head to the airport. We're receiving feedback tonight. In other words, when we're done, we're not looking just for questions. We're looking for comments of what you would like to see in this area. We got some feedback on Tuesday evening. We got feedback from others on Monday. And this gives you one more opportunity to provide us with feedback on what you would like to see in the final report. And we will digest that. We're going to be taking notes and making some changes in the study tomorrow and next week. When we finalize the study, this team is going to refine the report and finalize it. Again, as I noted, we're going to deliver it to the city within 1 month. The city will then review any recommendations. We have no authority to say, Franklin, you got to do this. We're recommending that they do some things. And BOMA, Planning Commission, and such are going to decide about the recommendations that we are making, and then they will implement any activities that they feel they need to undertake. And with that, we're going to go to questions. I'm going to move down to the other end here. And also serve kind of joke, even though I'm the team leader, I'm also the ringmaster. So as you ask questions, particularly, I will look down the table. I may tell one of the team members to take that question, or they may just naturally take it. And please, I will recognize you. No jumping in. Stick your hand up. I will say, you know, the person in the blue or the guy in the third row with the beard or whatever. And we will stay here until we answer all your questions and hear all your comments. So let me get over there first. The gentleman with the beard in the third row, go ahead.
You mentioned in part of the study about a community rating system. What would that consist of?
Okay, actually, we've been told that the city has started the process. This is a part of the National Flood Insurance Program, but it's voluntary. What it is the community, once they receive an audit that says, hey, you're doing everything you're supposed to, they tell FEMA that they want to apply for CRS. CRS is based, you know, are you familiar with fire insurance? Okay, it's kind of like the same thing, but for flooding. And the FEMA contractor comes out, helps the community complete an application, and based on activities that the community is taking, they receive points. For every 500 points they receive, there's a 5% reduction in the cost of flood insurance. Just so happens I used to be a CRS coordinator for FEMA Region 5, which is the next region north of here. And I've told the city that it's apparent to me that they're probably well on the way to at least a 5, if not more. A lot of it's based on area, and that's something that I couldn't figure out in the short time while we're here. And I can tell you that one of the comments that will be going into the report is that I'd recommend that once they get their first rating, to take a look at existing regulations and programs and see what they can tweak to get more points. There's a maximum of 45 points, or not 45 points, 45% reduction in the cost of flood insurance. I can tell you no community's got 45% reduction the first time around. But out in Mark's area, Roseville, California is a class one, I'm aware of that. And in the state that I live in, I know there's 4, 5s, and 6s. So, with that, yes, ma'am.
So, when you are talking about the Bicentennial Park area and you say finish the park plan, do you mean construct the park plan that exists for the Bicentennial Park, which is poorly named, as we know?
But yeah, it would be to complete the improvements that are planned already.
In fitting with Chicago, their Bicentennial Park got finished in about 2003. Yes.
Are those points just for the city itself's insurance or the citizens?
No, the city obtains the points. The points, you know, whatever rating the city should get, anybody with flood insurance in the city, when their flood insurance policy is renewed the next year, would receive that reduction. So it's, unless the city, you know, if the city has insurance on some buildings, yeah, they'd get it too. But it's any flood insurance policy holder. And I believe the figure that I've got is that the city has 441 policies currently.
Really help even more than it would help at present.
Right. Because of the continued payments for buildings in floodplains, you know, the National Flood Insurance Programs have been around since 1968. And since that time, anybody who had houses that were built before the maps came out got a subsidized flood insurance policy. In 2012, Congress decided via the Biggert Waters Act that the subsidy was going to go away. What they're doing is each year until the cost of the policy reaches actuarial rates, or basically the rates to cover damage that you'd receive, it's going to go up 25%. An example is I looked at the rating table, and in one area, and there's a number of different rates, but it went up from 79 to 99 cents per hundred. So that's 20 cents for every $100 worth of coverage that the homeowner would have. That will be added into the policy for any policies that are removed after, or are removed, are renewed after October 1st of this year.
I'd like to ask you, as a group, but maybe even individually, are there certain recommendations you feel particularly strong about? Are there particular themes across the recommendations that you would say, as a city, look hard about this? Think really, you know, there's a maybe a stronger feeling or consensus about certain things than other things. Can you highlight elements that at least at this point that you feel are important to give a little extra emphasis?
I'll start. As you noticed, I mentioned small area plans. Williamson County and Franklin are in a program. I believe the county city version is the multi-hazard mitigation plan. It makes the city and the county eligible for federal funds to mitigate damage, elevate structures, buy out structures. They actually do some other work, some drainage projects also. One of the recommendations is to purchase some of these structures that are continually being damaged, particularly the ones in the high potential damage area, both from the depth of flooding and from the flash flooding on Sharps Branch, and turn that into open space.
Yes, I think a real opportunity exists in this community to further exploit, and use that in the most positive sense of the word, your tourist opportunities. And a site that is absolutely precious is the Hill property. But you're only going to get one opportunity to exploit that property. If you blow it, you're out of a wonderful site for a long, long time. Near that hill property, you have already two cemeteries that lend themselves very attractively to cross-cultural tourist interests. You also have at that site, hill site, what we're calling the hill property, an opportunity to have some economic development activity. But it ought to be very sensitive activity. It ought to be at every instance human scale. And it ought to be something that is pliable, such that 20 years down the road, if there were to be a higher and better use, that could be exploited.
I would say probably the thing that I picked up on among the group that we were pretty strongly unified on was the need to not have new development north of Margin or north of Mount Hope, based on the fact that that's where the floodway has the most impact on properties there. That's going to mean that the community is going to have to figure out how are you going to buy out those property owners. Is it going to be through tax-funded purchases by the city? Are you going to work with a nature conservancy group or another nonprofit to help eventually purchase those properties and remove the buildings there? And I think the other thing we're pretty strong about, and Mark will probably talk about this more, is as you get south of Margin and south of Mount Hope, having the design standards in place, because you are going to have to elevate the buildings if you're going to develop anything there. And that is going to change the character of your community somewhat. And I think the dialogue that you need to have after we leave is, you know, which change to the community is more palatable to you? Is it to have new design standards and higher buildings, or is it to just eventually let the buildings go away and just have a series of vacant lots, which will also change how your community looks? So from my perspective, those are the things I think I felt most strongly about in most of the group.
That's good.
Thank you.
I think with my background and what I teach, I was very interested in applying resiliency and livability to solutions. I looked at resiliency. And resiliency is basically, if you have a disaster or something happens, that your community can bounce back quickly and retain its original features that you want to retain. And livability is so everybody can get around and enjoy the community, not just people that can drive or people that can walk, but everybody, all users, all ages, all locations. So one of the areas, I had the mobility table at the public meeting. So I looked at different pedestrian and bicycle connections, different ways where everybody could drive, walk, and bike safely together. Some places more appropriate than others, of course. So those are things that are integrated in the report. And then probably one of my other little pet projects, I was trying to think of some outside-the-box ideas to apply to development along Fifth that was a more of a resiliency type of application where when you think about the transition into the, like a gateway feature into the downtown, some kind of building presence would be ideal. But I also, when you think about resiliency and not wanting the flood, what can work? So how can you have your cake and eat it too? So I looked at some open air structure ideas where they're basically buildings with the roof that are in place. They're not transient, they stay there. But you have markets inside that can, places that can be leased out. You can have electricity run there, so you can have markets. You can have little groceries, different retail in there that can be transient and come and go. And if it floods, there's nothing there when it floods. And the water just goes right through it because it's open. And there's some descriptions and images in the report that talk about that. But that was kind of my outside-the-box idea that I wanted to contribute to the team.
Mark?
Yeah, so when I originally took a tour of the city on Monday. I was struck at how readable the city was, which works very much in your favor. With the exception of Hillsborough, and I was struck by the context in which exists along Fifth, and how it somehow didn't fit the rest of the community. In fact, it's as though you were entering someone's house and all the junk and stuff that should be stored is left on the porch, but you go in the house and it's immaculate. You know, it is sort of a doorway to the city.
And the construction doesn't help either.
Huh?
The construction doesn't help.
And the construction doesn't help.
No.
But I can actually see through the construction, so at least it's moving in the right direction. Mm-hmm. But it's the physical form is very broken, and so you don't have a continuous urban fabric leading you into the city. And that struck me. And so my interest, or the theme that I took away, and it was reinforced over and over and again through not only the stakeholder meetings, but also the public input workshop we had, was whatever you decide to do on Fifth, you've got to do something. We can't leave it the way it is. And it has to have mm-hmm. strong architectural and design features to it. And so my focus was on, well, what does that mean, both from a site perspective, but also from the public realm, and that's everything from the street to the sidewalks up to the very edge of a site. So some of my recommendations that you'll see in the report have to do with street edges and activation and how to get that part of town much more energized, similar to what you see downtown.
And just one more comment, one thing I forgot about, is a stream maintenance program on lower Sharps Branch. And by the way, you can get points on CRS if you implement that.
First and second.
Something I would like to see in your final report, in the area south of North Market is part of the core city, the original 16 square blocks. We have rather protective, thankfully, ordinances protecting historic property in that part of town in particular. But if one recommendation is going to be that new structures being built be elevated, that's out of character of the historic downtown district. So adjustments are going to have to be made to the historic zoning district. So some sort of comment, and I don't have any suggestions, but some sort of comment needs to be made that not only are we looking at flood mitigation, but we're also looking at it is going to change, at least in this area right along the floodplain, it is going to change the character of the historic downtown area. So our historic zoning ordinances also need to change and reflect some of those realities.
And I think that's kind of the what the team needs to do is show an example of what under these new regulations, what a development would look like, and then have the community kind of decide, is this really what we want to see here? And if not, there actually would be no reason to change our historic regulations, because that if that's the only type of development that could happen, perhaps the community wouldn't want that. And we're going to try to show you examples and to develop safely within this area, you're going to have to follow new regulations. So it's going to be back on the community to figure out if this is how you want to move forward.
And I'd point out that we've had 4 very busy days, and we still have an amount of work to do on this. So we could only get so much done in those days. This lady was first, and then the gentleman in the yellow in the back.
This is an out-of-the-box question, but that area right there needs to be elevated. All the new construction needs to be elevated and of course, done compliant with the historical manner that's desired for the whole city. But what if the city offices that are here relocated to that entire district right there, elevated with parking garages and state-of-the-art architecture type of thing, a whole campus, city campus coming into the city, and there you've got the campus of everybody right there, elevated, of course. Would the city get extra money and grants to do a project like that there?
For new construction, at least from FEMA, I would say no. From FEMA's standpoint, they don't like to see structures that are emergency related. And obviously, during a disaster, the mayor has to have contact with the community, and you have to have staff getting out. And I don't think that would be compatible. Gentleman in the back of his hand up.
We've been discussing the design of that area and I was reading the buildings for meetings and new ones and what have you. Has there been any within the state, I thought you was on this meeting, prior meeting, that we talked about doing now, or anything that being designed as opposed to both flooding itself. I'm a homeowner on the southwest corner of your map on my outside. I'm back to the yard back in that flood point. We talked about 2010 flood, but I had some flooding coming up to my home. April 27th, we had our main storm.
Well, it is.
And maybe the spring, you're out of that.
And Kelly, throw in, please, but if my memory serves me correctly, the flooding in that area was 6 to 8 feet. Let's say it was, just for the sake of discussion. You're talking about for every 1 foot in width, you need, or 1 foot in height, you need 3 feet in width for a levee. That means, and the levee would have to be 1 foot above the base flood elevation. Let's assume that the two are the same. That's 9 feet. Bavaya 27 wide, which would block out the park and the cemeteries, the access to the cemeteries, which probably could not be done. You've got some businesses there right now too, and the only way it could be done is if you had some kind of a mechanical device that would close the openings. The other problem with that is some of the flooding comes from Sharps Branch. And it would basically have to be what's, and you've got the Harpeth over on the west-east. So it would basically have to be a ring levee, which some of the sites both on 5th Avenue and over to the west on the river would also have to be vacated in order to construct such a levee. We considered it. Doesn't mean we're recommending it.
Well, I guess a simplified question, which I currently know the problems that I have as a homeowner with water.
Can you speak up, please?
As of April of this year, during our Main Street Festival, it rained very heavily on that Saturday. That Sunday, the water rose up to the back of my road. Which runs just south of Highway 96, on the south side, on the southwest corner of the path. I have other neighbors have that same problem. I'm just trying to see if you're working to figure out that the current situation, or we just looking at laying out plans, or who's happy with this type of building or that type of building. What are we doing for the flood? Anything.
Yeah, as far as doing something for the flooding itself, that wouldn't be covered generally by this plan. You're talking about upstream reservoirs to hold the water, to keep it from running down, or reservoirs nearby, and it's pretty much built out other than that area. That would be something to be determined by the Corps of Engineers, though not. Yeah, there was something we looked at. All we did was look at it.
You said, I believe, that no new development in the floodplain.
Floodway.
So, floodway.
It would, if you remember from that earlier picture, it was the deeper, faster flowing area. If you wanted an exact look on where the floodway is, Shana, you want to put up your hand? I'll pick on you. The city can determine which exact sites are located in the floodway.
Coming.
There.
That's it.
In the lighter area, then there is possibility of development or redevelopment.
Right. And that's where we're suggesting elevation. About the only area in the flood fringe we are not is near where Sharp's Branch and the river come together, because the Sharp's Branch is a what's referred to as a flash flood area. In other words, when that water comes down, you don't have any warning.
But you're recommending, or your report will recommend allowing development in the lighter area there, as long as the active part of development is above the flood.
Right, the building would have to be, the city's requirements, and we concur with them, are a commercial building, offices, whatever, have to be 1 foot above the base flood elevation at the site. If a residential building went in, you're talking about 3 feet above the base flood elevation.
What kind of stairway, or what kind of access do you permit or is permitted to get to the that level?
Natural stairs are allowed, also per the NFIP regulations, and I'm referring to all that. Elevators are allowed as long as they're constructed so that they're the lift type, not the ones that's like a lift in a garage, pneumatic type going up. So the city has access to a number of FEMA guidance documents on various issues, and if you came in with, you know, proposals, they would look at those guidance documents to see what's allowed. But, you know, steps are steps. They allow them. There's no problem. The problem is when it does flood, you lose access to that structure till the flood goes down.
Well, I would assume that there'd be some kind of general understanding between the occupants or amongst the occupants that they would recognize that, and you might even require post appropriate notice to that effect.
Possibly, but that would be the city's.
But you, and I'm trying to see if it's correct that you have no, under prescribed conditions, you have no opposition to that. Is that correct?
That's correct, as long as it meets other conditions. You know, in the one slide we talked about context. In other words, you don't want a building that's towers way over the rest of the buildings in the nearby area. And you may, if it's, you know, right adjacent to the, or in the historical district, then you have historical requirements you have to meet as far as what the building looks like.
Yes, sir.
It wasn't until after meeting Tuesday night that I realized that I probably own one of two elevated structures in the area. I'm wondering, we do not have a flood vent in the house. Is there, are there grants, are there funds that can be obtained to put them in the structure?
Not usually. There's a number of vents that are available by, you know, from contractors. What's below your first floor?
Dirt.
And overall, they're not all that expensive. I've seen communities that have gotten a grant and used it for like a revolving loan program for something like that. But that would be up to the community to apply for it. Remember, a lot of these grants, you're competing against other communities for them. The biggest amount of grants come after a disaster occurs, so it wouldn't get you ready for the next one. And that's because people usually aren't interested until they're damaged. But they could explore that.
This study, I mean, I'm impressed and excited to see this, but this is one area of the city that experiences significant flooding. And when you provide mitigation if the city were to provide mitigation here, how would it affect the area, you know, the area outside this study, that because the floodway and the floodway fringe flow throughout or throughout our city. I live in the floodway fringe, but not in this area, and was flooded in my house for 3 days in May 2010. Fortunately, I got no water in my house. But how does this, how do you put the pieces together, or how are you, how can the alderman put the pieces together to make this effective as I look at possible mitigation and redevelopment in this area?
Well, as I mentioned, the city participates with Williamson County with the multi-hazard mitigation plan. They would have to identify the various sites as sites that they want to proceed to do something about, to mitigate, as part of that plan. When money funds become available, like I said, the biggest fund is the Hazard Mitigation Grant Program after disasters. They're kind of slowing down a different one, which is disaster mitigation program. And there's also a floodplain management assistance program for people that are in the National Flood Insurance Program. But first you have to be identified as a site in the plan and the type of mitigation activities that the city would like to undertake. And it's basically, you know, working with the residents, are you interested? You know, what do you need? Putting it in the plan and waiting for the funds to become available. I would mention, though, that funds aren't just available if Williamson County floods. And I say the county because disaster declarations are done by county. The Memphis area had a major disaster and they didn't use all the funds in that area, the state, I assume it's the Emergency Management Department in Tennessee, would put out a notice to other areas of the state that funds are available and they could apply for.
Am I hearing you correctly when you say we don't build in the floodway? We don't build anything in the floodway, which is the dark.
Right.
That leaves the hill and the light portion of the map. And are you saying that you think our ordinance is okay with the 1 foot and the 3 feet elevation for whatever's built? So that leaves us to decide what to build and the hill. Is there anything else that I'm missing? Is that pretty much what you're saying?
That's probably the, if you take away one big piece of it, that's probably the biggest piece to take away tonight. But in the report, there's much more and a lot more details. For example, in the sections I'm working on, I have been making recommendations about changes you might want to make to your zoning ordinance. I know that Mark's been working on design guidelines. Kim spent a lot of time on the open air markets and mobility recommendations. You know, Bill has spent time on economic development issues. So we've covered a lot more than what you're seeing tonight, because we know you don't want to be here till 10 o'clock. But
they have the decisions that we would have to make about the light blue, what to put in there. And your markets and all of that would come into that.
Like the open air market?
Yeah.
Right, yeah. So, say for example, you know, one thing we talked about is right at the intersection of 5th and 96. We looked at not only, first of all, the big question was, do you develop it or do you leave it as open space and not develop it? So that was the big kind of umbrella question. And then from there, you know, we worked out two scenarios. If you develop it, these are the things we would recommend that you do. Changes to your zoning ordinance, types of uses that you want to see there, building design. If you don't want to develop it, here's other options. So, okay.
Could you clarify, please? Are you saying that development should occur in all the areas that are light blue, or are you saying that development should occur south of Margin and south of Mount Hope, and no development should take place north of North Margin and north of Mount Hope?
Correct. That's correct.
With the exception of some possible construction of ancillary, yes, thank you. Put my teeth back in. In the park, you know, like we talked about the possibility of a visitor center or a welcome center, a combination thereof, and you know, work on the old shoe factory to you know, the possibility of a farmer's market or an entertainment site. But other than that, that's correct.
She said no development in the blue area north of Margin. Is that, what you...
Well, most of the area north of Margin is...
Is a bicentennial.
Yeah, most of the area north of Margin is Bicentennial Park. It's not going to be developed anyways. And that's all parkland.
And we as in the report, we've also recommended that city purchase those properties that remain.
Wait, does he own franchise?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So this map is correct. It's actual. The dark blue area is the red line Main Street.
No.
No. That's the boundaries of the study area.
That's Bridge Street.
It's 96th and Bridge.
The city's GIS department created this map.
Yep.
Yeah, this is what's called Geographical Information Service map. The city took the FEMA maps and created an overlay on the topographic maps to create this. So I'm assuming that this is correct.
I think maybe you should have answered my question, but once again, if we can leave it as it is today, we are not going to be eligible for the funds from the state.
No, you're incorrect.
Incorrect.
If any of these structures that are there were substantially damaged, in other words, they were damaged to the point where the cost of repairing or replacing them exceeded 50% of the market value of the structure, not the land, the structure, and did nothing, the city would be in trouble with FEMA. And FEMA's standpoint as far as flood insurance is, if you get disaster assistance and if you don't have flood insurance, they require you to get it. If you drop the policy, then you're no longer eligible for any FEMA assistance from a future flood. Is that in or out of a floodplain on that map?
It's outside the boundary,
it's outside,
so we don't
outside,
know.
We don't know. Other than city zone regulations, whatever they may be.
Because I have
There are no regulations if you're outside the floodplain.
Just make them more confused.
I had water on my building that sits about right here, 4 inches up on my foundation. And I'm concerned what takes place up here can make that situation worse than me. My neighbors, specifically. And then, you know, the plant itself, it sounds like you want to have an open plant. Mostly, but it's very low development to keep that from happening. We're already in a situation, because I know in 2010, my house flooded 13 inches of rain. This year, it flooded 3.3 inches. It's close. So I'm curious what that's going to do to that area.
There are no requirements. I don't work for FEMA, although I used to. I don't work for an insurance company. You would be eligible for flood insurance.
And I did carry it. But what you're saying this year, do I have to do anything?
No. You're outside of the floodplain, so you're not considered a pre-firm structure, because that's for structures inside the floodplain, other than there any normal rate increases, which is different than the, you know, they have what they call actuarials that decide if the amount of money everybody's paying is going to cover the costs. They probably each year things go up a cent or two. But as far as the rate increases, the 25% rate increases, you would not be covered by that.
If I can chime in, because I think he was also expressing a second point about any development north of his property could change the pattern, the floodway pattern, or the floodplain pattern. And so, which obviously is a valid concern, but if the city decides to move forward on some development and adopts very strict regulations of what that development is, certainly it should not change the floodway pattern, meaning the flooding will still occur as it is, and the way certain buildings are designed is to accept that flooding on the ground floor, as opposed to pushing it away onto someone else's property.
As far up, Kate, I know in our tours, and actually Tom and I took a second tour in May here, not knowing where the water came from to your area, it could have come from Sharp's Branch. If you're just in a low spot, it could be what's called ponding. In other words, the ground won't hold the water, so it ponds up, especially if you're in a depressional area. If you're affected by Sharp's Branch, you're probably not going to be affected that much from water from the Harpeth River. But one of the things we're suggesting is taking a look at Sharp's Branch to see what else could be done to reduce the flooding on that stream. And it really would take, you know, a study on your property to discuss exactly what happened to you. And, you know, we can't do that. We can recommend it, but that's about as far as we can go. Well, downstream, yes. But if an elevated building generally is on pilings. You saw some of the, Mark, can you?
Yep.
The elevated building doesn't take up that much storage. So you've got some buildings that are on the ground there now. If those were replaced by an elevated building, those would not block the structures.
Everyone seemed to have the same question, and I'll ask you. And they're talking about. The Bank of America building, the car dealership that's there, the quite a long cash company that sits there. Are you recommending changes to those structures?
We're not recommending any changes along Highway 96.
No.
Well, the bank is on 96.
Yeah.
But we are recommending some changes north of there.
Yeah.
This lady had her hand up first and then. And okay. Go ahead, ma'am.
There are many historical areas that are being redeveloped that have gone through floods. And this is beautiful. We've visited some of them. And I think that if we could supply some designs that they could look at or make recommendations of areas where representatives from the city could visit, that would be very helpful.
Mark is our design person, so.
I know, I spoke with him a couple
ago. Yeah, I mean, I think the first strategy, obviously, is how this house functions or how the structure performs or functions during a flood. And once you can get that resolved, then you can start designing and look at character-defining issues that are compatible with the rest of the neighborhood. And so if you look at the top rendering, or model, I should say, we took and looked at, well, what does it mean to have a low-scale commercial structure in the floodplain, and how would it actually function in the case of a flood? And as you can see, on all sides, basically, the building would be penetrable, so that water flows in and flows out as though the building footprint wasn't there. And that's the whole intention, and that's why it goes back to the question about if you're putting a structure in the floodplain, you can't change the natural flood patterns. I mean, you can't push it down the road. You've got to work with the circumstances or the characteristics in which that site is handling. So there are a lot of ways. Once you get that part, that aspect resolved, I certainly think that the design question is an easy one to resolve, as long as you get competent designers, architects involved. Unfortunately, I can't because I don't know anybody from the Tennessee area.
Well, if you had some pictures that you could provide with the report of where you think it's been successfully done, sometimes a picture is worth
right.
a thousand
mm-hmm.
words.
The only thing with that, and we were very careful because I pulled a lot of pictures and renderings and proposals from all over. And the problem is that, you pull them out to show how it functions in a flood, but when people see, let's say, a modern structure on there, they automatically assume, oh, that can't be done in my neighborhood. Well, strip away the modern characteristics and place, a different kind of design strategy to it. And so that was one of our challenges. And as you can see, these are, I'm assuming these are the two houses on each side, the photos here. Are somewhere located in the south. They're built, they function in a flood area, they might be in a coastal zone. So it can work, we know that. So the trick is, you know, taking it a step further, because we heard a lot of comments, well, we don't want to see our houses on stilts. So the next thing is, okay, well, then let's see how we can conceal some sort of elevated structure. And so the middle one, which is also a rendering, shows you how someone concealed the actual stilts and still has a moderately, so I would call it a transitional. It's somewhere between modern and traditional. And then the rendering up top is a little bit more traditional. Again, it's concealed by a design or stair strategy that kind of conceals it from the public realm.
The other place to check possibly is the SHPO. The SHPO is the State Historical Preservation Officer. I have no idea who that is in Tennessee.
Yeah.
Okay, that would be the person to
that
go
would be
to.
A good place
because
to start.
Not only do they go in Tennessee, but they're always having national meetings. They all respond to the U.S. Department of the Interior. And I know Interior is beginning to come out with more guidance documents for disaster related, not only flooding, but tornadoes and everything else.
I would certainly recommend too, if you do get if an architect designer is available, that maybe you require that there's a historic preservation consultant as part of the team to make sure that anything being proposed is certainly compatible with the neighborhood.
The lady in the back that had her hand up, and then this lady here, and then over here.
We have, this property on North, across the left is the party room. And we had this maybe 35 years now. And
could you guys stand up?
Ma'am, could you stand up and so I can and speak up so everybody can hear?
Over the years, they've enlarged the parking lot. We've been there for 35 years. And the first, when we first moved in, we had 18 inches in the shops, but we knew we were in the floodplain. And then when they took down an old restaurant and flattened it out, and then they paved the whole thing, that's when we really started getting flooding in my building, even on normal rain situations. So I was wondering,
every site is responsible.
I put something in there about green components to all the new development, but I like that better. It's clearer.
And they raise it up just enough so that when the rain comes, it drains right into our property, right in the back, so we have it coming in from the cross way and that way. And they said they tried to help us with that and put a drainage in front of it, coming down north of that into a whole side. But still, we have this.
Detention.
I mean, I really like so that the old folks are there, and I don't want to have to put up a wall so that when it rains, we get 4 feet of water.
That sounds more like referred to as a drainage problem, and that is not something that we have addressed in this study. Kelly, who?
The only problem is it's diverting it. It's creating a new pattern. So you put up a berm that you're pushing the water into someone else's. Right.
Mm-hmm. The other thing is, if it's in the floodplain, the city has what's called a compensatory storage requirement. That means for every shovelful of dirt you put in, you have to take it out somewhere else. Yeah, because you've blocked the storage. You know, that's storage that's there now. It would have to be reviewed by the city. Okay, ma'am.
You mentioned in the presentation
built in the light area, won't they still have enough flood insurance?
In the area outside of a floodplain?
No, in the floodplain.
Light blue, yes.
Yes.
Well, yes and no. You know, you look at it at if you live there and it's not elevated and you get flooded, can you afford that either? And the other thing is the higher the structure is above the base, if there are no elevation requirements. And I don't know where you live, if there is, you know, maximum heights. For every foot above the base flood elevation you are, the lower the cost of the flood insurance.
They're more than 3 feet.
Oh, those are about, the two on the bookends are probably about 6 to 8 feet.
Looks like 8.
6 to 8 feet. Mm-hmm. The rendering above is 4 feet.
We were talking about that earlier before you.
Depends on the floodplain. That's not all true to the floodplain.
Right, and sometimes, and I'll use the one on the left as an example. They may have been required to raise it 4 feet, but they wanted to use that as parking area, so they raised it the additional feet. So part of it depends on, you know, what you're going to use it for, and part of it is the regulations. Yes.
First of all, I want to compliment you on the job that you've done, which has given up a week of your time to hopefully your employers continue your salary. So we thank you for coming down here. I think what you're giving the city is going to be a very workable tool. My comment is outside of your study and why you're here, but I think it's been brought out tonight. I am very concerned about the impact of the new road over Sharks Branch. In the past, there was a relatively small culvert right at where Sharks Branch enters the harbor. And now we've got a culvert that is probably, I don't know, 500 feet long. And it's a huge culvert. It's very large. But I'm concerned that flooding in the harbor is going to back up. It's going to fill that culvert. And it's going to back up. And it's going to push the flood even further to the southwest than what we've experienced before. And I understand that that's outside the scope of what you were here. But it's any comments that you might want to make regarding that potential flooding for the future might be appropriate.
Are you talking about the extension that wraps around 3rd and goes and hits a 5th?
Sharks Branch flowed over the ditch into the harbor, except for a small section of culvert right at the river. And now all of that has been enclosed at the culvert.
Okay. Which is he talking about?
That Constraint, where 3rd Avenue is going to tie in.
Yeah, so he's talking about that.
There's a culvert under the
other
just if I'm not mistaken, and Kelly can speak to this more, or some of the other elected or appointed officials, is that plan was in place and approved before the 2010?
No.
Afterwards? Okay. So, and done by, I'm assuming your public works engineers, in terms of studying.
So we have approved that. Yeah.
But the open ditch would fill and then spill out into the bank. Now it's all enclosed. A much greater distance of culvert is enclosed. And there's relatively a small area of open ditch. It's going to go back into another point under Millville Road.
I would suggest checking with the city's engineering department on that. A couple final questions. Sir.
There's been a lot of discussion on the 100-year floodplain. experienced it just recently. However, we have more occurrences for 5 and 10 years, but within this area. What considerations have been given for possibly retention ponds or other amenities that might help mitigate those areas, those situations within that area?
They would really not help much within that area. When you're talking about the flooding coming down, you either need retention upstream, like up, you know, Sharps Branch somewhere. You could possibly have some what's called green infrastructure. You know, some of the new houses that are going up Sharps Branch are putting in rain gardens, encouraging residents of the community to not just do it when construction's taking place, but doing it on their own lots to hold some of the water up there. Otherwise, the only option up there would be to buy a few houses out, demolish them, and put something up there, which would require that an engineering study would be done before anything like that would take place.
Was a big holding pond. Will that alleviate lessen flooding, or do you look at that?
I believe the Harpeth is regulated by the Corps of Engineers. They would have been the ones that would have looked at it. My understanding, too, is the Corps of Engineers are in the process of restudying the Harpeth River, and at least their preliminary map should be out next year sometime. But the National Office of the Corps of Engineers would be the one to comment on that. And the last question.
It's not a question, it's just a comment. I like the idea of the open space and the passive park area, and I love the idea of the open air market that y'all talked about, and also the hill property, because that's the gateway, another gateway. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Mayor Vernon, Eric, any last comments?
Well, y'all done a great job. And
thank you.
Truly appreciate your taking your personal time to come to Franklin, Tennessee, and we hope that in some small fashion Southern hospitality has rubbed off on you. Truly appreciate all the hard work. And so let's give them a final round of applause. And
you made it.
I guess.